Golan's present The Evidence by Christopher Priest, read by Michael Maloney. Chapter 1. Snow upon the Rails. What am I doing here? Why did I agree to it? 2 whole days of this? Such thoughts. I was leaning my head disconsolately against the window, feeling the cold from outside as it seeped through the toughened glass, watching as the train passed through an endless frozen landscape of heavy industrial works, derelict buildings, and spoilage. At intervals, white and orange floodlights glared down on concrete emplacements. I felt I did not belong, because no one could belong in such a place. The sky was the darkest grey like an old cinder. Daylight was only grudgingly admitted. The hills were streaked with thin snow. The train went slowly. Sometimes it stopped, sometimes it went even more slowly. I dreaded what would happen if the train broke down, or I was told to leave the carriage, or there was an unannounced change of trains at some remote junction. This train and this compartment were my only protection and a degree of familiarity. They insulated me from the frozen landscape beyond the glass. I was on an all-expenses visit to a distant university where I was scheduled to deliver the keynote speech at an academic conference. It was on a subject in which I was believed to be an expert, but in fact there was a twist to it I knew nothing about. The title of my lecture was the same as the title of the conference itself, The Role of the Modern Crime Novel in a Crime-Free Society. Crime-free? That was a new one on me. The paradox interested me, and it was one of the reasons I had accepted the invitation, but only after much indecision. I lived and worked in a place which was most certainly not free of crime. We experienced the usual range of thefts, assaults, drug and alcohol abuse. Less often, there were cases of fraud, arson, and murder. Not everywhere, and not all the time, but at a level where it remained necessary to maintain a full police force. Anyway, I had a vested interest in crime. I earned my living indirectly from it. I wrote thrillers. And there were readers everywhere who loved to read a mystery, a noir detective story, a police procedural. The assumption being proposed in the title made me wonder if the place I was going to was in some way different from everywhere else. Was there really, in this modern world, anywhere without criminals? Had the fear of crime been factored out of people's lives? Did everyone live a peaceable, law-abiding life? Maybe not. The conference would almost certainly be speculative, idealistic, proposing social reforms which would lead eventually to a state in which crime became unknown. That seemed more likely. However, I had been to academic conferences before. They are built around big ideas, but many of the individual papers produce much dry theorizing about side issues. I had already pleaded a busy schedule. I was not planning to stay for the whole 3 days. But still, somewhat against my better judgment and in spite of similar past experiences, I had accepted the invitation. This one included extras that I found attractive, if not compelling. A flight instead of a long sea voyage, a train journey that promised a first-class private sleeper compartment, meals prepared by a chef of international repute, free drinks, and personal attendance by stewards. The president of the society which had invited me, Professor Sorodai Wendao of the University of Dearth Historical and Literary Society, would meet me in person on arrival. There was going to be a suite at the best hotel in town. Although I was warned that I would be visiting during the winter months, I was assured that every creature comfort would be anticipated and catered for. I would, for instance, be driven everywhere in a university car, and not least, there was an honorarium, not a huge one, but sufficient. So why did I sit unhappily in my first-class compartment, still close to the beginning of the venture, regretting the fact that I had said yes? Trips like this one always used up more time than I allowed for, and more than anyone else might expect. As well as the 4 days of actual travel, 2 there, 2 home again, there were the days spent preparing for the trip, writing and rewriting the text of my lecture, worrying about it, worrying about the journey, feeling distracted by having to go away. Work on my latest novel had been hopelessly disrupted, and I knew that when I finally returned home, more days would be lost as I tried to pick up the thread from where I had left off. My publisher had also just sent me proofs of my last one, which needed to be checked. I find it impossible to concentrate on work when traveling, so I had left them at home. There was also the weather. I had been warned of sub-Arctic temperatures, even during the days, requiring heavily insulated outerwear. I had had to order this specially, and although the agreed expenses refund included a contribution to the cost, it was a contribution only. The padded coat, hood, trousers were so bulky they required an extra case, which I had to pay for as hold baggage on both aircraft, making a total of 4 baggage charges in all. My first flight had been early. The plane had taken off at about 4 a.m., but that was a short internal flight only, followed by a long wait. The second plane, to Trist Contenta Hub, had suffered a delayed takeoff because of an adverse wind forecast, which meant that there was a chance I might miss my connection. In practice, I was still able to catch the train with time to spare, but I knew there was only one sleeper train per day, and I had no idea what I would have done if I'd missed it. Apart from a snack at the airport, and another snack during the flight, I had eaten hardly anything all day. All of this was stress I could have done without. My first-class compartment was modern, clean and compact, but I felt strangely isolated. Once or twice I had ventured out into the corridor, hoping to see a steward or some of the other passengers. But there was no one about. It was almost as if I were the only one on board. The invitation to the University of Dearth in Dearth City, the administrative center of Dearth Island, had arrived more than 18 months earlier. The name was not appealing. I knew little about Dearth, and I had no ambitions to visit the place. I knew it only by its reputation for long, storm-riven winters and an economy based on heavy engineering and mining. I had spoken at 2 or 3 academic conferences in the past and so would not feel out of my depth, but I had said I would not stay the whole course. The general subject was within my sphere. I had published more than 12 novels, as well as essays and criticism. I was known in the world of crime writers, had even won a few prizes, but I was no academic. The prospect of prolonged and detailed academic discourse from theoreticians who knew little of the art and craft of writing filled me with dread. The months slipped by. Suddenly, it was 1.5 years later, and here I was, inching my way south across the island of Dearth, feeling hungry, wondering where the stewards were, staring gloomily at the bleak view outside. There was free Wi-Fi on the train, so as soon as the train left the railway station at Trist Contenta Hub, I had sent an email to my partner, Joe, just to let her know that I was on my way. I knew she was busy, preparing for a business trip of her own, one that sounded much more interesting and lucrative than my descent into the South Polar regions. Joe Delson and I had lived together for many years on an island called Saleh Raba, which translated from the island Patois as Fourth Island in the Saleh group. Unlike Chile Dearth, Saleh was in the subtropics, and consisted of 5 main islands, Saleh Yuel, Seconda, Tielet, Raba, and Hames, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th. They were all of more or less equal size, and because of the latitude, the trade winds, and the oceanic currents, they had similarly warm climates. All 5 islands had developed in different directions. Saleh Seconda, for instance, was a popular holiday resort, attracting visitors not only from the rest of Saleh, but also from all over the world. Saleh Raba, where we lived, had emerged as a centre of financial services, and most of the largest banks, insurance companies and pension funds had their HQs in Raba City. Joe and I lived in a tithable house on the edge of the sea, close by the unspoiled forest that covered much of that part of the island. We were by no means well off, but on the money I earned from my books, plus Joe's freelance income as a theatrical designer, we were able to get by. Dearth could hardly be more different from Saleh. Setting aside the climate, what I had glimpsed from the train so far was a grim industrial landscape with huge factories and furnaces, cooling towers, pipelines, broad access roads, advertising signs everywhere, much open-cast mining in the hills, towns built of small houses crammed together. The air was clouded with fog or smoke. Even inside the air-conditioned train, I developed a tight feeling in my chest and could smell oil or coal smoke or industrial fumes of an uncertain and probably dubious source. Although they were both large island countries, few people travelled from Saleh to Dearth other than for business. There was the regular air route linking them, as well as a long sea crossing, notoriously prone to stormy weather. Not many islands lay between us. The Dream Archipelago in the Southern Hemisphere had many clusters of inhabited islands, but only a handful were in the deep, rough seas, a long way to the south of Saleh. There was a sense of emptiness and oceanic vastness between the two countries. When Joe or I travelled, we normally headed east or west, or sometimes northwards, into the marvellous sun-baked islands in the horse latitudes of the Midway Sea. Dearth had never attracted us, apart from business executives and office workers. Those who did travel to Dearth were mostly backpackers, bird watchers, rock climbers, loners, extreme sports enthusiasts, modern questers or adventurers drawn by the wild, rugged and so far unspoiled terrain along the east coast of the island. I remember the plane I arrived on had flown low for several minutes above this sort of landscape. The pilot came on the PA and said that because of the weather over the sea, we had lost more than an hour of flying time, but that Dearth was known for its gravitational anomalies and that we could take advantage of one of them. He advised us that we need not reset our wristwatches. Well, I hadn't the least idea what he was talking about. He delivered the message in the bland, supposedly reassuring voice that flight crew often use when speaking to passengers. Whatever he meant, it turned out that when the plane finally landed in Tristcontenta Hub, we were in fact about 10 minutes ahead of the scheduled arrival time. I had no idea how that could have happened, but once I was inside the terminal, I noticed that my wristwatch showed the same time as the clocks. What did a gravitational anomaly look like, and how had the pilot found it? I had no background in science, certainly not physics. I fancifully imagined there must be a metal grid or a dome out there, or a series of masts with lights on, but there was nothing in the darkness. It could be anywhere. I was bored. For a while, I read one of the ebooks I'd saved to my laptop, then I glanced through my speech again. I made a couple of small changes, improvements. I listened to music on my headphones, then because they isolated the sound, I took them off. The train was moving faster now, but there was still no sense of urgency. Marooned in my pod compartment, the only sounds I heard were the noises from the wheels and the track, and it still seemed to me that I was alone on the train. Dinner arrived without warning. Two young men I assumed were stewards brought a trolley and placed the food unceremoniously before me. Chafing lids concealed the dishes. There was a small bottle of red wine included. There appeared to be no choice offered by the chef of international repute, but by then I was glad of anything. One of the stewards released the catch on the sleeping bench, brought the whole thing down with a muted crash, then smoothed and straightened the sheet and pillow. Soon after this, the train slowed suddenly and came to a halt somewhere in unlit countryside. Total silence fell. The dinner had left me unsatisfied. It was served dry, it was salty, the sauce had congealed, and the portion was small. The following morning, I was awakened by the sound of voices in the corridor. I dressed quickly and opened my door. I recognized one of the stewards from the evening before. I asked him why the train had stopped. "The track is the wrong gauge," he said, "walking on. Too narrow, we can't use it, happens a lot, they'll fix it, we can make up the time later." I thought about that, trying to make sense of it. How could railway track, used by trains every day, the permanent way, suddenly be the wrong gauge? And how could they fix it? I looked through the window of my compartment. A blizzard was blowing outside, and the snow was already building up against the side of the train. It looked like we might be stuck there for hours. But then suddenly, the train lurched into motion, slowly at first, then with increasing speed. I returned to the pod. I read through the text of my speech again on my computer screen, then made sure all my tiny changes, emphasis, clarity, etc., had been transferred by hand to the hard copy. The hours passed. I was fatigued by being on the train, the endless movement, the noise from the track, the dry-heated atmosphere, the sheer tedium of being contained inside a bleakly modern capsule for nearly 2 days. Outside, we were passing through snow-clad scenery, much of it high and rugged, looming over the track. From the satellite map on my cell phone, I knew this was the final stage of the journey. Dearth City was fringed by these peaks, but the mountains went on and on. The train was going slowly again, shaking between the peaks, laboring on the ascents. I started preparing myself for disembarkation, glad of something active to do. I sent a message to Jo, telling her I would shortly be arriving in Dearth City. I hoped the reception party from the university would be at the terminus to meet me, as promised. I wanted to be driven to my hotel as soon as possible, take a shower, shave, put on some clean clothes, prepare myself for my speech. I pulled on the Arctic outfit, feeling as if I were wearing a spacesuit and having a similar lack of dexterity. I put my smaller case, the one I would normally travel with, inside the now vacant larger one, and slung my computer tote diagonally across my shoulders. According to my cell phone satellite map, we were now only a short distance from the terminus, so I parked my padded backside on the edge of the desk I had been using. Because of the sudden appearance of condensation, I could see little or nothing through the window. I watched the map rolling slowly along. The train made three or four more braking lurches. The last one felt definitive. Glad to be out of the sleeping cabin at last, I squeezed and maneuvered my way through the narrow door and into the corridor. Here at last, I saw several of my fellow passengers emerging from their own compartments. Everyone was bundled up in thick layers of padded clothing and carrying or porting their luggage. One by one, we waddled towards the outer door. It was then I felt the touch of the first tendrils of the sub-zero air of Death City. It was a profound shock. I had literally never felt anything as cold as that before. Chapter 2. The Mystery of the Two Keys. I clamped my gloved hand across my nose and mouth, trying to filter or slow the icy air. I could barely see. I managed to step down to the platform without falling, but other passengers, presumably more accustomed to the cold than me, pushed past. A wheeled suitcase ran over my foot, although because of my thick boots I barely felt it. The owner of the case looked back at me as if I had deliberately put my foot in his way. The platform had been freed of ice and snow in a narrow, cleared passage alongside the train, but most of the platform was covered in old, compacted snow, uneven and dirty. I followed the other passengers along the platform, tramping unsteadily. People in a hurry weaved past me, stepping off the cleared passage onto the hard frozen snow because I was going too slowly. Several of them glared at me as they slithered past. The freezing cold air was now having a weird effect on my tongue and throat. I kept my lips pressed together as much as possible. My eyelids were starting to feel stiff. I reached the station concourse. This was high-roofed and ill-lit, with the winds blustering in through the open sides. Loud music played constantly, echoing and distorted, even through constant station announcements. There was no sign of anyone waiting to meet me. I put down my bags and waited as the other passengers dispersed. Then a quiet voice beside me said, "Dr. Fremde?" I barely heard the voice because of my inner confusion and all the noise. Someone had stepped up beside me. "Yes, I'm Todd Fremde," I said. So wrapped up against the cold was the figure that at first I had no idea if it was a woman or man. A long scarf and a tightly closed hood contained all but a small circle of face, itself mostly hidden behind protective glasses. "Welcome to Dearth." The voice, closer now, revealed its owner as a man. "I am Soradai Wendo from the Historical Society."
"Yes, we exchanged letters. You invited me."
"I'm pleased to meet you at last, Dr. Fremde. I hope you had a good journey."
We made an effort to shake hands, but our thick gloves made it almost impossible. My teeth were suddenly aching from the cold, and breath was a drifting cloud of vapor around us.
"I'd like to go to the hotel before anything else," I said.
"We might be able to take a taxi, but it's better we should walk. We can go straight to the venue."
"I'd prefer to drop my luggage at the hotel first."
"Not much time for that. You can leave your bags in the office."
"You said you were going to meet me with a car?"
"That's generally in use by department staff at this time of the week. It's not too far to walk."
"I'd prefer to hire a taxi," I said. "I will only be a few minutes at the hotel."
"As you wish, Dr. Fremde, but I think you'll find there's a long queue for the taxis outside."
We made our way with difficulty across the concourse, having to step several times around groups of other heavily weather-insulated people. Once we were outside the main part of the station, there was indeed a queue, but I was determined not to yield. I did not want to walk an unknown distance in this freezing place, in these bulky clothes. After about 5 minutes, a small group of taxicabs turned into the station yard, and we were able to hire the fourth one. We piled into the small passenger compartment, dragging my luggage in with us. He gave the driver instructions to the Plaza Hotel. I said to Wendo, "If you don't mind waiting, I really will be only a few minutes. I just want to freshen up after the journey and collect my thoughts before I deliver my speech."
"Of course." Wendo was peering ahead through the grimy front screen of the vehicle. "As a matter of interest, Dr. Fremde, we were wondering about your university career, which is your alma mater. Where exactly did you gain your doctorate?" I'm an author, a writer. I'm not an academic. I write thrillers and mysteries.
Yes, we did rather gain that impression. Even so, you must have studied somewhere.
I have an honorary doctorate, I said. It was given to me by the Citizens University of Saleh, awarded a few years ago. They like my books, but I never use it as an honorific, and in fact, I'm surprised you even know about it.
We have ways and means of checking out our speakers, Wendo said. A citizens' university, you say? How very fascinating. That would be a college for serfs, I take it. We don't have a system of honorary degrees on this island, so we're unused to the concept. Saleh. You've had to come a long way.
Yes, I said, it's a lot warmer than this place.
Of course, I was thinking about the university.
Culturally, Saleh is renowned, but Wendo had abruptly lost interest. He began typing on his cell phone, having slipped two detachable finger covers from one of his gloves.
He was holding the phone in his other massively gloved hand, so I couldn't see what he was doing. He completed his message, then quickly slipped the finger covers back into place. Soon afterwards, the taxi arrived outside a large, concrete-built edifice, a rectangular block with small windows rising up in an orderly grid. The sign carrying the hotel name was partially obscured by grime, not snow. I noticed that Wendo was not readying himself to leave the taxi with me, and that the cab's meter was still running.
I just need a few moments to dump my stuff. Will you wait for me here with the cab?
No, I can't do that, he said. And I sensed his impatience with me. I have to go straight to the conference hall. You should be with me. There are a couple of important guests I want to welcome, whom you should meet. However, we are now running a little late, and I need to make certain our practical arrangements are in place. Because I've been on leave, my assistants have been preparing the conference.
Then how will I get across to the hall, and where exactly is it?
I've sent texts to two of our History Society members asking them to collect you here at the hotel. He said, they will meet you in the lobby in a few minutes' time. They know what to do and where to take you.
All right, I said.
He was staring at me, waiting for me to leave. I opened the taxi door to a massive inflow of freezing air. I struggled past him, having to pull my bag past his legs.
Should we exchange cell phone numbers in case we need to make contact?
My main bag fell onto the frozen pavement, and my computer tote was swinging down from under my arm and across my chest as I stepped, crouching and awkward, from the cab onto the slippery surface. I staggered to regain balance. Wendo reached across to the inner handle of the cab door and slammed it closed with a forceful movement. The vehicle drove away moments later while I was still straightening. I could barely glimpse even Wendo's dark shape through the condensation of the taxi's windows. The moment I passed through the hotel's triple-door complex, I felt I was back in an understandable world. The doors closed swiftly behind me, and streams of warmed air came down from ceiling grills. The reception area was large and light-filled. Soft classical music played unobtrusively. The atmosphere was fresh, but overall maintained at a pleasant temperature. Lights were recessed, the carpet was thick-piled. Close to a piano on a podium, not being played at that moment, there was a loose, informal arrangement of dozens of armchairs and long settees, clustered beside or around tables. Many groups of people were sitting about in the relaxed atmosphere, talking and drinking. Every table had a small, independent electric fan heater beside it. I could smell the appetizing aroma of well-prepared food and saw direction signs to two separate restaurants. The reception desk was a long, gentle curve following the back wall of the lobby and was staffed by two young men and two young women.
I felt huge and disruptive in my heavy outside clothes, but I assumed the staff would be used to people moving in and out through the doors. I began unzipping my bulky padded jacket before I reached the desk and removed my hood. I pushed my protective glasses up my forehead. I felt the strap briefly adhering to the skin of my cheek. I presented the confirmation booking I had been sent by the Historical Society several weeks earlier. The young man who was attending to me glanced quickly at it, typed something at his keyboard, and then looked up at me.
Dr. Fremde?
Yes.
Welcome to the Dearth Plaza Hotel, Dr. Fremde. I hope you will enjoy your stay with us, citizen sir. It is just for one night, I believe, and you are alone?
That's correct.
Is this the first time you have visited Dearth City?
Yes.
He typed some more, then produced a room card and an electronic key. He wrote the room number on the card, made sure it was the same number he'd seen on his monitor, and turned the card around for me to see.
You are in room 627, Dr. Fremde. That's on the sixth floor. The elevators are in the corridor around the corner, he added, pointing to the side. Are you familiar with the use of elevators in the city?
I assume so. Presumably...
You won't have any problems, Dr. Fremde. All the elevators have printed notices reminding what to do in an emergency. This is a period of vertical stability, so none of that will apply to you tonight. On the other hand, as this is your first time, I have to inform you about mutability arrangements. I notice you are a citizen serf of the Seigneury of Salé.
Yes, I said, wondering how much longer this would take. I was anxious to go up to my room, take a shower, and so on. A second electronic card had appeared in his hand, and he was sliding it across to me. It was the same size and shape as the other one, looked slightly thicker, and was white all over with a bright red border. A computer chip was embedded close to one edge. Apart from a hotel logo, nothing was printed on the card itself. Again, you are unlikely to need this card tonight, but the hotel rules insist you carry it at all times. Mutability is a problem many people who visit Dearth have never experienced before, but while you are staying at the Plaza Hotel, we ask that you treat it with great seriousness so that you will fully enjoy your stay. What exactly do you mean by mutability? I said. You'll find all the information you need in your room. Always use the standard room key, that is the one for locking and unlocking your door. He started speaking more quickly and insistently, as if he had recited the same words many times before. Under Senoral Mutability Regulations, we have a legal requirement to provide you with a second key. This will also open your door or any other to which you are directed. You must only use the second key if the first one does not work properly. Hotel management are always on hand, here in reception at street level, or in any of the mutability stations. There is a mutability station on every floor of the hotel. If you experience any difficulties at all, you can always find someone to help you. Both keys must be returned to reception before you leave the hotel.
It sounds terrifying, I said, trying to get an informal, unrehearsed response from him.
A routine, sir, he said. The last mutability crisis in this hotel was 17 years ago. I had just started school. The incidence level is currently flagged at green. I hope you will have a most pleasant stay.
The young receptionist turned away from me with a professional smile to greet two more arriving guests. They were crossing the lobby with a slow walk, as thickly wrapped as I was. The man and the woman pushed up their protective eyeglasses, revealing their red-rimmed eyes and their eyebrows whitened by frost. As they passed me, I felt the deep chill of the outside air still clinging to them. I ascended to room 627, and for a few minutes I was free of mutability warnings, inadequate doctorates, irritated hosts, or mysterious keys. The room had an opulent feeling of luxury, cleanliness, privacy, and comfort. There were flowers in a vase, a bowl of fresh fruit, and a notice that the minibar was fully stocked. A handwritten note from someone called Norie told me that she was my roommate and that any requests I might have could be written on the notepad provided. The room, large and luxurious though it was, could not be described as a suite, as promised by the invitation letter, nor had I any idea if this really was the best hotel in Dearth City, also promised, but it was abundantly better than anywhere I had stayed before. Warm air circulated gently. I stripped off my outer clothing with a sense of relief, tossing everything aside and making an untidy heap in the center of the carpet. There was a radiant electric fire, programmed to pour out heat with fierce purpose for 1 minute at a time. I squatted on the stool that was provided, driving away the last vestiges of the sub-zero chill from my hands and face. I then used a second minute for my ankles and feet. I ran a tub of hot water in the bathroom. I removed the rest of my clothes, then stood in the warm and steamy bathroom while I shaved. Finally, I plunged into the tub and lay there for several minutes, glorying in the hot water. For the first time since leaving home, I felt happy and comfortable. I was dressing when my cell phone vibrated. I did not recognize the number. A male voice said, but hesitantly, "Is that Dr. Fremde?"
"Yes, this is Todd Fremde."
"We have come to collect you, citizen, sir, and will be honored to accompany you to the conference center. We are waiting in the lobby."
"I'm still getting ready. Can you wait another 5 or 10 minutes?
"We are already late, sir."
"I'll be down in 2, I said.
I experienced a faint frisson of irritation. I had been through this before, the sudden requirement expressed by other people that I needed to hurry up. I had been travelling for nearly 2 days. What was I now late for?
I was, after all, the sole attraction that evening. What else is the role of a keynote speaker? I did not delude myself with self-importance, but in every practical way, the event could neither start, continue, nor end if I was not there. For what other event that evening would I make them late?
Well,
Maybe there was a practical reason. A curfew, perhaps, that would define the finishing time, or an hour after which public transport no longer ran. But I have grown aware of this sort of possibility affecting other people's lives, and I try to allow for it when attending an event away from home. Wendo, in his various communications to me about this trip, had said nothing about a finishing deadline, but I supposed it was possible. I completed dressing more quickly than I would have liked, aware of someone waiting for me down in the lobby. I did take an extra couple of minutes to leaf through the text of my speech again, pencil in hand. I always found something that could be improved or corrected, so it was that evening a misspelling no one but me would even see, let alone take any notice of, but I made the correction anyway. I then spent a few more seconds taking 6 deep breaths to calm myself, this always worked, and made sure my speech was complete and the pages were in the right order. Finally, I slipped my cell phone, the hard copy of the speech, and a couple of pens into my computer tote. On the interior of the room door was a printed notice I'd not spotted before. Mutability awareness. To all guests, when exiting your room, always be sure to turn off all lights and other electrical equipment. We have to remind you there is an extra charge if you ignore this rule. See our standard conditions. Thank you. I read this twice, puzzled by it, but the hotel was an excellent one, and I assumed there must be some reason. I quickly made sure everything was off, then let myself out of room 627, took one of the elevators already waiting on my floor, and descended to the lobby area. To save time, I had not put on my heavy outer clothes and had everything bundled up under my arm. I headed straight for the reception desk, not glancing around to see if anyone was waiting to meet me. The male receptionist who had checked me in was no longer on duty, but one of the women staff came forward immediately. I held up my room card for her to see and said, "I have to be out of the hotel for most of the evening. Are there likely to be problems moving around the city later on?"
"No, sir. Public transport runs until 1 in the morning and taxi cabs can be hired all night."
"Thank you. And if I should need a meal later, will the restaurants here still be open?"
"The grill room is open 24 hours. Snacks can also be obtained in any of the bars."
I nodded to her and turned away, but immediately bumped into someone who had come up quietly and was standing right behind me.
"Dr. Fremde," he said from behind his mask and goggles. His voice made him sound nervous. "We are from the Historical Society."
I realized then that another small person was standing close behind him. "I'm ready to leave," I said. "Let me put on my warm clothes first." The one who had spoken to me took hold of my computer tote for me while I struggled to put on the thick garments. With 2 people watching, I felt clumsy and self-conscious. One of the heavy sleeves made the arm of my jacket right up inside, meaning I had to take the thing off and start again. Finally, I had the top half in place. I reached down and wrapped the protective lower flaps around my legs and pulled the drawstrings. I put on my hooded cap and eye protectors, settled them around my head. Throughout all this, neither of the students offered to help, but stood gawkily by. They were probably in awe of me, but I really wish they were not. "I hope you brought a car," I said. "I don't want to walk a long way." They glanced at each other.
"It's not far, Doctor," said the one still holding my computer tote.
"The conference hall is in the next block," said the other. 5 minutes.
10, said the other, and handed me back my computer bag. "There's a hill."
Outside, deep night had fallen, and a sharp wind had risen across the streets. The uncomfortable but warmly protective insulated clothing did what it was designed to do. I could soon see the conference center ahead of us, floodlit in the night. It was true that there was a steep hill up to the entrance for the last 500 meters or so. We took it at a steady pace. The entrance to the hall was unostentatious. Its steps and pathways had been entirely cleared of snow and ice. As we pushed through the triple door system, I glimpsed a poster announcing my speech. My name was prominently displayed. I was described as Dr. Fremde. I decided not to spend the rest of the evening explaining I was just a writer. Chapter 3. The Lost 2 Hours. As soon as I arrived, I realized that everyone must have been waiting for me. A local courtesy. There was a concerted rush towards the bar. Rows of filled glasses were standing there waiting to be drunk. If the students who collected me had mentioned that there was a party being delayed until I arrived, I would have understood, hurried up, skipped the irritated feeling. Still, they were not to blame. Conversation roared around me. Waiting staff circulated with trays of canapés from which I managed to extract a single bite, raw fish, cream cheese, and some kind of vegetable. Later, someone gave me a glass of wine, as because of the press of people, I could not get to the bar. I did not particularly wish to see Professor Wendow, but if he was there, he was keeping out of my way. My hosts now were two graduate students, one male, one female, from the revisionist history department. In the noise, I could not hear their names clearly. I liked them both and was attracted by their easy conversational style, and as an unsought-for bonus, by their apparent familiarity with several of the books I had written. Without going into reasons in detail, I asked them both not to address me as doctor, saying I preferred the use of my given name. They were fine with that. The ice was being broken in many different respects. After another 5 minutes, the woman disappeared from the party to return moments later. She said the audience was seated and ready for me to begin. It seemed the crowd of partygoers were not the audience, or not entirely. Several people were drifting away in the direction of the auditorium, but most appeared to be staying on at the drinks party. The couple led me to the platform, where three red leather chairs and a lectern were waiting. There was a good if polite round of applause. I was introduced twice. The woman spoke knowledgeably of some of my books, and the man gave a brief summary of my professional life and various achievements and awards. I stepped forward to the lectern. The remote control for the slideshow presentation was in place. I had forwarded the software a week earlier, and someone from the society had replied to say that it had been tested and was working. It was too late now to make certain of that. The role of the modern crime novel in a crime-free society, I announced, hearing my voice amplified, but perhaps not by enough. I moved closer to the microphone. I took a pause, apparently to gather my thoughts, but in fact, because I wanted to gain some idea of the size of the audience. This was not vanity. It is a mistake I have learned to think of an audience as a single entity. They are individuals spread out across the auditorium, an unmeasured space if the speaker has not been there before, and usually one undefined by limits if the place is not full. A speaker addresses them as a whole, sometimes in the plural, but they listen as single people. You need to know how best to address them. Some are further away than others. The house lights were dimmed, but I could still see that the auditorium was large and banked with an upper layer. No one was up there. The audience was spread all over the ground floor stalls, with, at a guess, about a quarter of the seats taken. A few more people were coming in, finding somewhere to sit. It struck me as a good-sized audience, compared at least with some of the ones I'd travelled to in the past. I pressed the remote, then turned my head to make sure the first image was up on the screen. It was, and in focus too, so far so good. I launched into my lecture. What did I say in my speech? If I were to claim that the whole thing was unique, inspired by the challenge of the occasion, it would be untrue. Every year I'm invited to give about 3 speeches, talks, or lectures. They're given in response to suggestions or requests from the group or organization inviting me, and most of them are informal in approach. Sometimes I'm asked to speak generally about the crime writing genre and what I think about it. At other times, people want me to talk about my most recent book or about earlier ones. The talks vary in length and intensity depending on what I expect or hope the kind of audience it will be. The main point is that because I'm usually working on a new book, I do not have the time or energy to think up something original every time. I recycle past efforts. I therefore have a sort of template which I use as a basis for any talk. This makes certain points about thrillers and mysteries that I always wish to state because I believe in them. I see them as a rationale not only for the books I have written, but also as a way of evaluating the work of other writers in the genre. The template is the bare bones for the rest of what the speech contains. I always reshape, sharpen, bring in ideas more directly relevant to whatever I have been asked to speak about. This is the difficult part. In this case, the Historical Society had proposed an idea to me that I had not considered before. A crime-free society. Thinking about it, I was struck not only by the possibilities, but also by my ignorance of the subject. While still at home, I tried to work this out calmly. I had never visited Dearth, had barely even heard of it. None of the reference books I usually looked in even mentioned the place. Online encyclopedias were not much help. Dearth was treated as an anomalous island, secretive, run by a hardline seigneurial family who were rarely seen in public. They encouraged industrial expansion and the performing arts, but restricted personal freedoms of both the vassal class and the citizen serfs. It was described as a stimulating but challenging place to visit. The mountainous wilderness on the eastern side was said to be ideal for activity holidays. The island was the site of several gravitational nodes which had erratic side effects. The idea of a crime-free state on the island of Dearth was described as alleged. Alleged by whom, I wondered. There was still an active police force. I sensed a risky subject. One approach suggested itself. I could discuss the impact such a policy might have on my own work, whether it were real, I suspected it was not, or aspirational, more likely. I made no pretentious claims for what I do. I write crime fiction, pure and simple, and make my living from it. I am a commercial writer. I complete about one novel a year, sometimes with a couple of short stories written when inspiration on the novel temporarily fails. Thrillers assume crime is a reality in the world, that murder is an intermittent but common event, that every killing or grand larceny needs to be dealt with firmly. A police force is therefore a requirement to catch the wrongdoer, as is a system for punishing or rehabilitating the offender. Crime should be discouraged. Mysteries need to be solved. Justice must be done. But how would that sort of fiction work if the reader, as well as the writer, lived in a world without crime? What would be the point of fiction assuming the presence of something that no longer existed? It was enough to suggest a few ideas for my lecture, and I worked them into the draft. With that done, I set it aside and took another look at it a week later. This was about a month before I was due to depart for Dearth. During the remaining time, I went back to it occasionally and gradually expanded it, changing the order of words a little, adding more ideas, deleting passages here and there, thinking up other examples to illustrate the theme. I read it aloud twice. Then there was the visual presentation, the slideshow. Cause for much extra thinking and sighing. In recent years, many audiences have grown to expect a slideshow of images, which ostensibly illustrate the talk, but in reality either duplicate what the speaker is saying or distract from it. The software is widely available and easy to use, so no excuse there. But I continue to dislike it. At one talk I gave 3 years ago, I illustrated it with some stunningly graphic scene-of-crime images taken by police photographers. Halfway through, I noticed that most of the people in the front row were staring glassy-eyed at the screen, no longer listening to what I was saying. That was not the idea at all. Ever since then, I have tried to assemble images that complement what I'm saying, but are neither too interesting nor distracting. The Historical Society said they saw a slideshow as an important part of my presentation, so I put together what I hoped would be some appropriate accompanying images. I had timed my speech to last 3/4 of an hour. That was longer than I would normally aim for, but Professor Wendo insisted in one of his communications that the conference required at least that much material. The longer of my 2 practice readings had come in at 40 minutes, so I planned to pause briefly between paragraphs, take sips of water, and so on. I noticed that Professor Wendo still had not shown up, or at least was nowhere in sight of the podium. So I began. I proceeded slowly. I had removed my wristwatch and placed it on the lectern where I could see it. After 20 minutes, I was halfway through, more or less on target. Once, when I paused to take a sip from my glass of water, I was able to half-turn towards my 2 interlocutors and received reassuring smiles from them both. The next time I paused, I glanced down at my wristwatch and was disconcerted to discover that in the few minutes since I'd last looked, the watch seemed to have stopped working. Although it has a quartz movement, the display on the face is analog sweep hands. The second hand was stationary. I shook the watch in the way you are not supposed to shake electronic devices, then realized that, of course, I was being observed. I put down the watch again. I noticed that some of the people in the front 3 rows, the ones closest to me, were also looking at their own wristwatches, or in many more cases, glancing at their cell phones. I pressed on. Time was not of the essence. I had minutes to spare. Briefly distracted by the problem with the watch, I read my speech more quickly, but soon realized what I was allowing to happen and refocused. The slideshow was now 2 images behind the plan, so I swiftly brought that up to speed. In control of my material again, I headed with a feeling of confidence towards the conclusion. The applause at the end seemed genuinely enthusiastic. I smiled at and acknowledged the audience, sorted the pages of my speech into a neat pile, collected my wristwatch, and headed back to the red leather chair. My 2 introducers were on their feet, and they applauded and congratulated me as I sat down. Questions and answers followed, a familiar pattern. While the 3rd question was drawling along, in reality it was, of course, a long and only half-audible statement from someone in the audience, who would doubtless conclude with the polite challenge, "What do you have to say about that?" I slipped my wristwatch back on my arm. I had time only to notice that the second hand was moving normally again, but that the time shown was more than 2 hours later than I thought. 2 hours had gone by? I essayed a brief answer to the statement come question. The young woman sitting beside me called for the next one. Three more questions followed, or it might have been four or five. My energy was low. It was hours since I'd eaten a decent meal. I was having difficulty hearing some of what was being said. There was a local accent, or maybe people were shy of speaking up. My mind was starting to drift. I did not want to seem dismissive or rude. Somebody asked me about crime and religion. Somebody else asked about my feelings on capital punishment. While this continued, several people in the audience left their seats and headed for the exits, their arms full of thick outerwear. I turned to my two interlocutors, hoping for a sign that they too thought we should wrap it up. To my relief, the young man instantly sprang to his feet. He made a brief speech of thanks for my invaluable and fascinating speech, one which he was sure would provoke much discussion in the days ahead. There was another ripple of applause, the house lights came on, and most of the audience began to drift away, pulling on thick wind cheaters and hoods. It was over. Not quite. Four people came forward to the platform with copies of some of my books. Fatigue was blurring me. I signed these copies as quickly and politely as I could, answered some friendly questions, showed interest. These were people who actually bought copies of books, a small but valuable race of beings in my view. When one of these people leaned forward to hand me his copies, I happened to notice that the wristwatch on his arm was showing the same time as mine, the wrong time, more than 2 hours ahead. I said nothing, but the next books came from a young woman, and making some kind of pleasantry, I made a point of turning over her arm to see the time on her watch. It was the same. She appeared to understand my interest and muttered something good-natured about not taking any notice of it. I was happy with these people and felt inadequate in the face of their encouraging and polite remarks. I wished I'd had the energy to say more, to find out a little more about them. Then it really was over. Backstage, I located my outer garments and my computer case, made myself ready for the cold dark outside. By the time I had everything to go, I was just about alone in the place. I found my way to the main exit and trudged slowly down the steep hill to the Dearth Plaza Hotel. It was further away than I remembered. Chapter 4. Lights in a Darkened Room. As soon as I was in the hotel elevator, I began removing the winter clothes, starting with the drawstringed leggings. I found my room, entered, switched on some of the lights. It was warm and well ventilated in there. I felt exhausted. The 2-day train journey, the stress of delivering a lecture, and above all, the lack of food. I threw off the rest of the bulky clothes, then lay down on the soft quilt of the bed. I was on my side, stretching myself in the way my cat Barmy often did, arms and legs straight out, back arched, eyes closed. Then I rolled up into a fetal huddle, making myself breathe steadily. 5 minutes later, I realized that the tiredness was really a result of hunger, which I could readily put right. It was a relief to be myself again, not play the role of celebrated visiting guest, nor a pseudo-academic, nor a lecturer, and so on. I sat up, temporarily refreshed. I booted my computer and logged onto the hotel Wi-Fi. This was swift and painless, but I did glimpse a message that appeared as a click box at the bottom of the page of Terms and Conditions. I accept and understand the conditions of broadband mutability. The risk level is currently 6%. To proceed, click here. I clicked there, and after a welcome screen and some options about long-term use, which I did not need, all went ahead normally. I glanced at incoming email, at the Saleh news feed, at the web pages and social media I always scanned, then contacted Joe by email. I simply wanted to reassure her that I had arrived and all was okay. But there were difficulties from the start. When I typed the word Dearth, the email server would not for some reason accept the letter H. All okay here in Dearth. I was forced to type even after several attempts. Joe did not appear to notice and did not comment in her reply. The letter H appeared normally in here and everywhere else I needed it. As I was signing off, the letters D disappeared from my name. Taw. I closed down. I wanted dinner. I put my computer onto battery recharge. I freshened up, combed what is left of my hair after 47 years of male life, then left the room. I was halfway along the corridor towards the bank of elevators when I remembered I'd not switched off all the lights. I went back. Inside the room, I read again the message on the door. I wondered what the usual charge was they warned against for breaking this rule. I also wondered how the hotel would know what I had done. Did they have a camera? A meter? Next to the message was a special holder containing a tall, narrow booklet entitled What You Need to Understand About Horizontal and Vertical Mutability. I riffled through it, thinking about dinner, But the print was small, there were words and phrases I did not immediately recognize, and the important stuff was summarized in big letters on the last page. These said, in effect, always turn out all the lights and every electrical appliance when you leave the room. The air conditioning and heating were specifically exempted. I took it literally. There was a master switch on the wall just inside the door, but I went around and switched off every light I had earlier turned on, and I disconnected the computer recharging cable. The television was showing a standby light. I turned that off too. I then used the master switch in case there were other electrical devices, such as timers, sensors, or thermostats I didn't know about. Whole plots can turn on details or missed details. That was something I understood, even when I missed them. I hurried down to the grill room. It was an airy place of subdued or indirect lighting, quiet background music, and comfortable tables within discreetly lit booths. The menu was extensive and varied, the service prompt, courteous, and helpful. The restaurant was not full. From where I was sitting, I could see other diners at about six tables, small groups or couples. I was the only one eating on my own, but halfway through my meal, a woman with grey hair came in by herself and was shown to a table on the far side of the room. Not at that moment caring whether or not this meal was included in the cost of my overnight stay, I ordered.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.